When we last left the book of Hebrews, the writer, presumably the Apostle Paul, had just finished chapter 6 of the letter, wherein he stopped his original arguing and his point-making from chapter 5, where he had first mentioned Melchizedek, and then said at the end of chapter 5 that he had more to say on that subject, but at that time it was not appropriate to speak on it. Not that it was inappropriate for him, but more that they, the audience, was not ready to hear it. And then he proceeded to write throughout the rest of chapter 5 and all through chapter 6 what basically amounts to a long sidebar where he, as we noted in the last discussion of that chapter, appeals to the heart of the audience, steps away from the hard logical discourse, and just speaks directly to the emotions of these Christians who are thinking about leaving Christ. And he writes to them and appeals to them that if they should abandon Christ, they would have no hope of recovery, because if they abandon Christ, to whom would they turn for recovery and a right relationship with God? The only way to be right with God is through Christ. If they abandon Him, they would have to find a new Messiah, crucify Him all over again, do the whole process over. But even then, that would not work, since there is but only one Christ. And so, that finished that little section, that kind of sidebar, at the end of chapter 6, where he had stopped what he was talking about, where he was seemingly about to discuss Melchizedek. Appealed to their heart, and then he ended that where he basically left off. And in fact, if you are reading this, you could almost separate chapter 5, verse 11, through all of chapter 6, and just set that aside, which is what it is, it's an aside, and read chapter 5, verse 10, where he says Christ was called of God, a priest after the order of Melchizedek, and then jump all the way over to the end of chapter 6, after he makes his great appeal to the heart. He says, where the forerunner for us is entered, Jesus, made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Exactly where he left off before he went off on this tangent, to speak of Christ as a priest like Melchizedek. And that is what the discussion is in chapter 7 of the book of Hebrews, as we're going to read in just a moment. It's important to remember as we study this chapter in particular, that this chapter is not about Melchizedek. This chapter is about Aaron and Abraham and the ways in which God used who they were and what they were and what place they held to show in the future, which is at this present, that Jesus Christ is superior, that His law is superior, that His priesthood is superior. This is not about Melchizedek. The only reason Melchizedek is involved in this is in the comparison to Christ. Christ is a priest not like Aaron. He is a priest like Melchizedek. As a matter of fact, really what you could argue is this chapter summarized in this sentence would be this. Christ is greater than Aaron because Melchizedek is greater than Abraham. And how he explains what that means and how it pertains to this book is what we'll notice in chapter 7. Without further ado, let's just read the chapter from the King James Version. It's lengthy, it's 28 verses, but then after we have read it, we can break it down verse by verse. Now being familiar with the content of it. Hebrews chapter 7, beginning in verse 1, the King James writes, "For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace, without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abides a priest continually. Now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of his spoils. And verily they that are the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descent is not counted from them receives tithes of Abraham, and blessed him that had the promises. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. And here, men that die receive tithes, but there he received them, of whom it is witness that he lives. And as I may so say, Levi also, who received tithes, paid tithes in Abraham. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. For if therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for it under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek, and not be called after the order of Aaron? For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. For he of whom these things are spoken pertains to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spoke nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident that after the similitude of Melchizedek there arises another priest, who is made not after the law of carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. For he testifies, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. For there is verily a disannulling of the commandment, going before the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh to God. And inasmuch as without an oath he was made a priest, not without an oath he was made a priest. Verse 21. For those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath, by him that said unto him, The Lord swear and will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament, and they truly were made priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever lives to make intercession for them. For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, made higher than the heavens, who needs not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once, when he offered up himself. For the law makes men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, makes the Son, who is consecrated forevermore. You could argue that Hebrews chapter 7 really begins in Genesis chapter 14. So let's just pause here and let's look at the context of what the writer alludes to in the very beginning of this chapter, speaking of Abraham and when he first met Melchizedek. We turn over to Genesis chapter 14 and we read verses 18 to 19 and 20 is really the crux of it, but let's, to get a more complete picture, Genesis 14 beginning in verse 16. Now this speaks of Abraham after he had fought off the armies of the four kings with all of his servants, and that's just a few verses before that. After this happened, he took all the spoils that he had gotten from those battles, and that brings us to Genesis 14, 16, and he, that is Abraham, brought back all the goods, and had brought again his brother Lot, and his goods, and the women also, and the people. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him after his return from the slaughter of Chedorlaomer, and of the kings that were with him. So there's several kings that are going to come and see Abram at the Valley of Sheba, which is the king's dale. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him, and said, Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which has delivered thine enemies into thy hand. And he gave him tithes of all. And that is your one and only reference to Melchizedek from here all the way until Psalm 110, where David, out of the blue, in speaking on the Messiah, alludes to his priesthood, or alludes to him as a priest, first of all, and then alludes to that priesthood being one like unto Melchizedek. And if you were just reading the Bible through, you would think, I've heard that name before. Where have I heard that name? And you see it here, Genesis 14. One of many kings that Abram meets, but interestingly, the Bible only speaks of Abraham paying tithes to this king in particular, the king of Salem, a town that would later be known as Jerusalem. And so as he's on his way to Jerusalem, he meets Melchizedek, presumably coming from Jerusalem. And your Bible, in the Old Testament, the pronouns are vague at the end of verse 20. It just says, he gave him tithes. And so just by looking at the Old Testament, you would have no more than just a guess, an educated one perhaps, as to who was giving whom the tithes. But Hebrews spells it out that Abram gave the tithes to Melchizedek, and not the other way around. But it's interesting that we get mention of Melchizedek as a king and a priest of the Most High God. But of course, we need to remember this predates the institution of the nation of Israel, where priests were a set in group of people from a specific tribe among the grandsons of Abraham, incidentally. And that before that time, this time now of Abraham and those around, this was the age of the patriarchs, when God would deal with people not through a nation, not through prophets or spokesmen, not through his written word, but rather through through the patriarchs. That means to say the heads of those households. How did Noah know to build the ark? He didn't read it in his Bible. He wasn't told it by a prophet. God specifically, directly told him to build an ark. How did Abram know to leave Ur of the Chaldees and go to Canaan? How did he know he would get there when he got there? He didn't read it in his Bible. He was told it by God directly as head of the household. And so this was this day and age. And so there's no stretch. There's no difficulty to understand how Melchizedek came to know the God of the Bible, came to know the God of the world, the universe, and become a priest of that God, the only God. And so here he meets Abraham, and Abraham gives a tenth of those spoils that he got earlier from his battle to Melchizedek. For what reason? Your Bible doesn't give the reason, at least in the Old Testament, as to why Abram paid the tithe. So we can speculate, we can assume, make an educated guess, that he was, that Abraham knew he was supposed to do that. How he knew that could be because Melchizedek told him as a priest of God. It could be that God told him as a patriarch, told Abram. It could be that, well, I guess those are the only two options, aren't there? But for one reason or another, Abram paid his tithes to Melchizedek, the priest, and he knew to do so. And he would not be mentioned again, Melchizedek would not. He drops off the map, you don't think anything of it, until Psalm 110, and then once again he drops off the map until Hebrews, when he's brought up again as one of the core arguments to show Christ is superior in his nation, that is the church, his law, that is the New Testament, his priesthood, that is the sacrifice of the cross. All of that is better than the equivalent of it in the Old Testament, the nation of Israel, the sacrifices of animals, the priesthood of men. That Christ is better than the old in every conceivable way. And one of the core arguments of that is Melchizedek. And now we begin the book of Hebrews, chapter 7, verse 1. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, all that we established from Genesis 14, met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. That is, Melchizedek blessed Abraham. The pronouns, again, in Genesis 14 are a little vague, though it's pretty obvious there that Melchizedek is the one doing the blessing, because it says, he blessed him and said, Abram, and so on. But still, to make it certain, it's Melchizedek who blessed Abraham. And as we'll see later on in this text, it is always the greater who blesses the lesser. The writer, presumably Paul, is setting you up for the understanding that Christ is greater, his priesthood, than Aaron's, because Melchizedek is greater than Abraham. And since Aaron came from the seed of Abraham, and Christ's priesthood is like Melchizedek, if Melchizedek is greater than Abraham, Christ is greater than Aaron. That's the overall, that's the overarching point he's making in this text. Verse 2, to whom, to Melchizedek, also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, that is, of those spoils. First being by interpretation, he gave them to this person known as the King of Righteousness, though there's no reference of that, incidentally, in the Old Testament to calling him the King of Righteousness. So I'm not certain exactly what that means. But then it says, King of Salem, and the word Salem means peace, thus King of Peace. And then it says of him, we get a little sliver of insight into this person, Melchizedek. It says he is without father and mother, though that doesn't mean he doesn't have a mama or a daddy. It means he has no genealogy that is recorded. There is no record of him other than that one, two verses that you get in the Old Testament of that man. You have no record of him, his father, his mother, his grandfather, and everyone that predated him, and those who came after him. And that's critical, not just to making this person mysterious, that's not his point of being, but rather to influence your understanding of his priesthood. If he has no father that is recorded, to whom did he inherit the priest? It's left vague. We don't know if he inherited it from his father or if he was just given it directly by God, the office, though I think that's the case. We have no record of any sons he ever had or even that he had sons. So how do we know if his priesthood was passed on? And that's the point. We're not supposed to know so that the priesthood can be looked at as perpetual, one that never had an official ending. And that's why it's like Christ's. So he is without father or mother, without descent, again, genealogically speaking. Having neither beginning of days nor end of life. This is all very parallel. It's parallelism. He's saying the same thing in different ways. He had no beginning of days recorded. No end of life that's recorded. No tombstone you can find. Melchizedek lived, died this date or that. Nor end of life, as we said. But was made like unto the Son of God. His reason for being a priest was to be a comparison to a person who would not live for thousands of years later. Christ Jesus. So he was made like unto the Son of God. And in that, in one specific sense, his priesthood abides continually. Why? Because no one, by record, replaced him as a priest. Unlike, here's your comparison, to Aaron, who had someone replace him, that was Eleazar, his son, who had someone replace him, that was Phinehas, I believe. And Phinehas was replaced by Uzzi, I think. The list, in other words, when Aaron died, his son replaced him, and his son replaced him. With Melchizedek, you have no record of a son replacing him. Therefore, it's a perpetual one. Like Christ, a perpetual priesthood, thus greater than Aaron's, one that's not tied to physical death. Verse 4, now consider how great this man Melchizedek was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of his spoils. Now, what is the relevance of it? What is the significance of it? He's going to get into. But he's establishing that it is significant that Abraham paid tenth of his wages to, or the spoils, to Melchizedek. He wouldn't do that to just anybody. There's no record of him doing it to anybody other than Melchizedek. So why? Verse 5, and verily, they that are the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, that is, of that tribe, who receive the office of the priesthood under the old law, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law. Now that's cutting to the chase, basically. The priests actually took the tithe from the Levites, who took the tithes from the people. But cutting to the chase, the priests took the tithes from the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, even though they all came from the loins of Abraham. They're all the sons of Abraham, or the son was Isaac, the grandson was Jacob, but the great-grandchildren are the 12. So even though they're the great-grandsons all equal to Abraham, one is given a unique task among those 12, and that is that the other 11 pay tithes to him. Verse 6, but he whose descent is not counted from them, that would be Melchizedek, who's not of the grandchildren of Abraham, received tithes of Abraham. And see the difference. You have with the children of Levi, through the priests rather, through the children of Levi, being given tithes of their 11 brethren. The priests are given the tithes of the 11 brethren. But Melchizedek, who's not one of the sons, was given tithes of Abraham himself. Obviously, one is greater than the other here. Verse 7, and without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. The one to whom I give the tithe is by nature better than me, because I'm giving him the tithe, and he is blessing me because of it. Who blessed whom in Genesis 14? Melchizedek blessed Abram. It goes downward. I can't bless God. God blesses me. I can say, blessed be God, and he is. But I can't bless God. I need God to bless me. I have food in front of my plate and I say a blessing for it, but all I'm doing really is I'm asking God to bless the food because he's greater than me. The greater blesses the lesser. The lesser tithes to the greater. Melchizedek blessed Abram. Abraham tithed to Melchizedek. Melchizedek's greater than Abram. Verse 8. And in this verse he'll say here and there. Here being the Old Testament priest, there being Melchizedek the priest. Here, you have men that die receiving tithes. What that means, we'll talk about in just a second. But there, he directly received them, he received them, of whom it is written, a witness rather, that he lives. The one who receives the tithes under the Old Testament system is specifically the high priest. He calls him the one who dies because his office is tied to his own living. Once he dies, Aaron, the first high priest, received the tithes directly, personally received the tithes. He did so until he died, and then his son, Eleazar, the next one who would eventually die, received the tithes. Then when he died, his son took over and received the tithes. So he who dies here under this system, the Old Testament, is the one who receives the tithes, the high priest. But there, with Melchizedek, he directly received them, and he received them of Abraham. And he never died. I mean, he personally did physically die. He left this world, but his priesthood never died. His priesthood never had to change because of his death, you see. His priesthood was continual. And so the tithing of Abraham and the inherent nature of Abraham tithing to Melchizedek will forever be established. Melchizedek is greater than Abraham. Now, verse 9 is a kind of, it's a very hard verse to read and probably to have been translated. My Bible says, verse 9, "And as I may so say." In other words, what the translator is trying to get across is, the writer is basically saying, and in a sense, or he's saying, and in a way, or you could say, something like that, you could say, Levi also received tithes, and Levi also who received tithes, paid tithes in Abraham. You could say that Levi, who receives the tithes of his 11 brethren, also paid tithes to Melchizedek. Just so there's no question, Levi himself is less than Melchizedek. You could say Levi's less than. Why? Well, because in a way, Levi paid tithes to Melchizedek too. Well, now how did Levi pay tithes to Melchizedek? Verse 10, "For Levi was yet in the loins of his father." Well, his father was Jacob, who became Israel. His father was Isaac. His father was Abraham, his ancestor, the word means. You could say Levi paid tithes to Melchizedek too, because Levi was in the loins of Abraham. Because Levi is a descendant of Abraham, if Abraham is less than Melchizedek, all of his descendants would be as well, in that very narrow sense. So he paid tithes, being in the loin of his father, when Melchizedek met him, that is, met Abram. And so his point from verse 1 through 10 is to establish Melchizedek is greater than Christ, or rather, greater than Abraham. And if Melchizedek is greater than Abraham, then Christ, whose priesthood is compared to Melchizedek, his priesthood is greater than the priesthood that followed after Abraham, which was Levi's / Aaron's. And that's why he brings you to the conclusion in verse 11. If therefore perfection came by the Levitical priesthood, and the people received that priesthood under the law of Moses, what further need was there for another priest to rise after the order of Melchizedek? And let's finish the verse. And not be called after the order of Aaron. That's Psalm 110. In other words, if, as the Jews say, the Levitical priesthood is the end-all, be-all of man's relationship to God, to go through that Levitical priesthood, if that were the case, then tell me why did Abraham, the ancestor of the Levitical priesthood, if you will, pay tithes to Melchizedek, whom God, in Psalm 110, compares Christ's priesthood to, and says he will have a priesthood that's not like Aaron's, end of verse 11, he'll have a priesthood that's like Melchizedek, to whom Abraham, Aaron's descendant, or ancestor rather, paid tithes. Why would God compare Christ's priesthood? First of all, why would God say there's another priesthood coming? Number one, if the Levitical priesthood is the best. That's the first thing he says in verse 11. Why would he say there's another priesthood coming if God doesn't need another priesthood? And number two, if the Levitical priesthood is all that is good and wonderful, if it is the end-all, be-all of priesthoods, then why would God compare Christ's priesthoods to Melchizedek's and not Aaron's? There's a point there. Verse 12, "For the priesthood being changed from the Aaronic priesthood to the Christian, the Christ priesthood, because the priesthood was changed, there is made of necessity a change of the law." What's the reference to that? Go back and look again in verse 11. If perfection, that means salvation, could come by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law. Under that priesthood, the people had and maintained and followed the law of Moses. In other words, when I broke the law of Moses, I had to go through the Levitical priesthood to rectify it with God. So the law is connected to the priesthood. And bosom buddies connected at the hip. So the writer's point is, verse 12, if the priesthood changed, as God said it would, Psalm 110, Christ has a new priesthood, one like Melchizedek. If the priesthood changed, and the priesthood is connected to the law, then it stands to reason the law would have to change as well. Verse 13, "For he of whom these things are spoken," that means Christ, the new high priest, "pertains to another tribe." Christ is not of Levi, though he's called a high priest. "Of which no man gave attendance at the altar." That is to say, Christ is of a tribe that no one offered sacrifices under. Aaron was of the tribe of Levi, to whom the people offered their sacrifices, or through which people offered their sacrifices, the Levitical priesthood. But Christ is a different priesthood who has no connection at all as a priest to the tribe of Levi, right down to his birth, verse 14. "For it is evident," you can look up the genealogy, "that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spoke nothing concerning priesthood." You look at Leviticus, Levi, Leviticus, that describes, that letter does, that book does, the formation of the priesthood under the nation, the tribe of Levi. My Lord, the high priest, came out of Judah, a different tribe. My Lord is not allowed to be a priest under the old law of Moses. My Lord may not. He's not allowed to be a priest under the Levitical system because he's not of Levi. He's of Judah. Therefore, he has to be a different kind of priest. One like Melchizedek, verse 15. And it is yet even more apparent. For that after the similitude, the likeness, the similarness of Melchizedek, there arose another priest. It's obvious. You can't read Psalm 110 and not come to that conclusion. Another priest, verse 16, who was made not after the law of carnal commandment. He's a priest not because the priest before him died, as was the case with Eleazar when Aaron died, he took over. He's not a priest after carnal, living and dying commandment, the commandment of when he dies you take over, but rather after the power of an endless life. Because Christ never will die again, he died and rose, and that's when he became a priest, incidentally. And because he will never die again, his priesthood will never be changed from him. He will always be the case, be the high priest. That's the connection to Melchizedek. That's why it is similar to Melchizedek. A lot of people have misread this and thought that Melchizedek was Christ, that he was like a representation of Christ in the Old Testament. No, the writer clearly says that he was someone who was like Christ, similar to Christ. In the same way Moses was like Christ, because they were both deliverers, they were both lawgivers, they were both savers of the people from the shackles of torment. Moses physically, Christ spiritually. In the same similar thing, Melchizedek is like Christ. Both are priests. Both are greater than Abraham. Both are different kinds of priests than the Aaronic priesthood. Verse 17. For he testifies, once again he quotes Psalm 110, thou art a priest forever, after the priestly order, after, similar to, Melchizedek. Verse 18. For there is verily, there is of a truth, obviously, a disannulling of the commandment. It is obvious, therefore, the Old Testament has been signed, sealed, and done away with. Its purpose been served. A disannulling of the commandment, going before for the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. The Old Testament is called unprofitable. Why? Well, first of all, because it was unprofitable, it was removed, disannulled. But why is it called unprofitable? Verse 19. For the law, the old law, could make nothing perfect, as he already alluded to back in verse 11. Perfection could not come by the Levitical priesthood, or God would not have promised a new priesthood, one like Melchizedek's, one that will never change, which implies the Levitical priesthood would change. Why does it need to change? Because it was unprofitable. Why was it unprofitable? Verse 19. It could not make you saved. It could not make you perfect, complete. But the bringing in of a better hope did. The hope of a new law brought in your perfection, your spiritual salvation. The bringing in of a better hope did, and by that we are drawn near to God. Drawn nearer than I could ever be by going through an earthly high priest. Nearer than I could ever be by following the earthly Levitical priesthood. And verse 20, and insomuch as not without an oath he was made a priest. In other words, Christ didn't just become a priest. Christ became a priest with the oath of God behind it. In other words, God said, you will be a priest and your priesthood will never change. Thou art a priest forever. He didn't say that of Aaron. Notice verse 21, for those priests were made without an oath. God never gave them the guarantee they would stay forever intact. But this, Christ's priesthood, with an oath, by him that said to him, the Lord swear and will not change his mind, my Bible says repent, that thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. 22. By so much was Jesus made a surety, obviously, of a better testament, a better agreement between God and man. The Old Testament, the old agreement between God and man, through which man worked and had a relationship with God via old high priest, is now replaced by a new agreement, a new testament between God and man, where man's relationship with God goes through the unchanging priesthood of the Son. Verse 23, and they truly were many priests under the old law. There were many priests because they were not allowed to continue. Aaron could not forever be the high priest. Why? Aaron died. Eleazar, who succeeded him, could not forever be the high priest because Eleazar died, and so on. By reason of death. But this Jesus, because he continues forever, he'll never die, has an unchangeable priesthood. Obviously, one follows the other. If he's a priest and he never dies, and priesthoods change by death, then his priesthood will never change. Wherefore, because he'll never die, he is able to save them to the uttermost. He is able to save them as fully and as completely as you can be saved. Versus under the old law, where you could not be fully saved. You could have your relationship with God rectified in a limited sense. You could be made right with God in a very narrow sense, in that God won't look at you directly as a sinner anymore. I mean, you still are a sinner, but he doesn't look at you in that way because you've done what the law required of you to do. But you cannot be fully saved. But here, Christ can save you to the uttermost, all the way in there and back again. Save them to the uttermost, that come unto God through him, seeing he ever lives to make intercession for them. Just as the old high priest made intercession to God for the people, but it was limited in scope, Christ has no limit. Verse 26, and just to bring the comparison home, he says, verse 26, for such a high priest became us, who is holy, that refers to his divine character, harmless, a being without malice, undefiled, sinless, separate from sinners, exalted above sinners, made higher than the heavens, exalted as God to the throne of God. 27, he who needs not daily, as those old high priests, to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the people. He's greater than that. For the law made men high priests which had infirmity. That answers the previous statement. That's why they had to offer first for themselves. But the word of the oath, that means the new law, the new agreement between God and man, which is since the law. Since the law has no longer been in effect, the new law has come into effect. It made the Son, now not literally made, in other words, it provided the high priest as a son, who is consecrated, made holy and pure and sinless forevermore. He offered his own sacrifice. In fact, I don't even think I read that at the end of verse 27. The old high priest, middle of verse 27, had to first offer for his own sins and then for the people's. But Jesus does it because he offered himself once, literally once and for all, when he offered himself. The old high priest had men with infirmity. The word of the oath has the Son, who is sinless forevermore. So which high priest is better? Christ is better than Aaron. Why? Because Melchizedek is better than Abraham, who paid tithes with Levi in his loins to Melchizedek. And if Melchizedek is greater than Abraham, then the priesthood, like Melchizedek's, would be greater than the priesthood of Aaron, which followed like Abraham. Therefore, Christ is greater than Aaron. So what are you doing, wavering Christians, thinking of leaving the Christian priesthood, of which you're a priest and Christ is the high priest, to go back to the old system where you weren't a priest and you had to follow these men of sin who were priests and high priests? Obviously, one is better than the other. Now, that doesn't end the discussion of the priest and his function and his sacrifices. That will come up again later. In the next chapter, he's going to describe some of the particulars of the Old Testament system and the sacrifices and the emblems of the tabernacle and later the temple, and make comparison to that, to its spiritual counterpart in Christianity, and again show how one is greater than the other. But we'll leave it there, and we'll pick up chapter 8 this time next week. Till then, thank you for listening.